you do help in developing a personal vision board. Help me
Sure.
understand what is a personal vision board.
So, whenever I have been asked this question, and whenever someone comes to me saying that, Anish, help me develop my personal vision board, and I always begin with making them aware of why they wake up every morning and what drives them out of the bed. What is that one thing? And the moment they realize that everything that they are going to do henceforth comprises of their personal vision board.
Welcome to another episode of The Brand Called You, a podcast and podcast show that brings you leadership lessons, knowledge, experience, and wisdom from hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. If you're new to our channel, please consider subscribing to it and hit the bell icon so that you never miss an update. I'm your host, Ashutosh Garg, and today I have with me a very accomplished entrepreneur, a member of the EO, Anish Patel from Gujarat. Anish, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Mr. Garg. It's an honor to be here and a great pleasure to have a conversation with you.
Thank you. Anish is the founder of Mind Maestro. He's an entrepreneur with a wide range of life experiences, and he's a qualified EO forum facilitator. So, Anish, let's talk about Mind Maestro. Tell me about the work you do here.
At the Mind Maestro, so if you don't mind, I would like to give a bit of history. It actually happened by chance. So my core business is of industrial and medical gases. So I supply oxygen, nitrogen, and these days a lot of...
You must be very much in demand these days.
Very busy and trying to make sure that all the needs are fulfilled. But over a period of time, I evolved and I changed with the forum experience that I was having at EO, at Entrepreneurs Organization, which led me to... become a trainer myself, because I thought I could add value, and of course I want everyone to experience what I have been experiencing. From that, it gave me confidence that I think I'm able to, coach people. I'm able to mentor people. I'm able to walk them through their own life, make them more self-aware of what they are. And which inspired me to learn and develop also a few of my own tools that have been working for me in my business. And that led me to do something professionally. But I never did it professionally. As in, I did it professionally, but I never marketed myself. I was never out there. So only through word of mouth, it kept on happening. And then came a point where I thought, I think I need to put a structure behind this, because a lot of people are calling me one-on-one. And they want me to engage with their leadership team, with themselves, setting up vision, purpose, values, goals for the whole year, and so on and so forth.
Yeah.
So that's what we do at Mind Maestro. So it's basically using your heart. All entrepreneurs do have a very, sentimental connections to what they do. And it's just to bring about that awareness of what they want to do, what drives their purpose and passion. Use their mind to articulate, exactly how they're going to achieve it. And then how they communicate through their voice. So we use these three areas at the Mind Maestro. A combination of this helps them achieve what they want to achieve. It happens through various things, workshops, one-on-one coaching. And I'm also looking at developing a very extensive LMS, which will help a lot of entrepreneurs and their teams engage virtually online so that they can learn and grow through the Mind Maestro platform.
Very interesting. So when I was reading about you, you do help in developing a personal vision board. Help me understand what is a personal vision board.
So, whenever I have been asked this question, and whenever someone comes to me saying that, Anish, help me develop my personal vision board, and I always begin with making them aware of why they wake up every morning and what drives them out of the bed. What is that one thing? Mm-hmm. And the moment they realize that everything that they are going to do henceforth comprises of their personal vision board, whether it is business, whether it's expansion, whether it's division, mm-hmm. whether it is taking family vacations, whether it's doing one-on-one with their children, whether it is just a break with the spouse, or whether they're taking care of their parents, or if they're doing philanthropy, which area they're in philanthropy. So everything that they do in their personal life then revolves around what their purpose is. So personal vision board is a great exercise, extensive exercise. It takes a lot of time, but digging, the maximum time it takes is to dig into what is their purpose, what really drives them to get out of the bed every morning and start doing.
Very interesting. And going one step further now, you also speak of five dysfunctions.
Correct.
So for all our viewers and listeners, tell me, what are these five dysfunctions?
So interestingly, it's a book written by Patrick Lencioni. And I would really recommend that everyone reads that book, The Five Dysfunctions of a Team. And I do a workshop on that, but I think all credit goes to Patrick for this amazing concept that he brought up. We always talk about what is functional in our organizations mm-hmm. and what is functional in our teams, but we seldomly even address things that are not working in the favor. And that is what are these five dysfunctions. And the base of the five dysfunctions is, first and foremost, the absence of trust in any leadership team, in any organization, or any groups for that matter. At times there is absence of trust, which is not openly spoken about, but there is, in the back end. And that's one of the dysfunctions, that there is absence of trust, and which leads to fear of conflict. Because they don't trust the mechanism, or they do not trust the group openly, they're afraid of giving their opinions, their suggestions, their ideas. So when I say conflict, it's not really getting loggerheads, mm-hmm. but it's about also constructive criticism is also a conflict, because that leads to a conversation that needs to come to a consensus. Mm-hmm. So because there is no trust, there's a second dysfunction, which is fear of conflict. There is no healthy discussions happening, brainstorming happening, which leads to lack of commitment. Mm-hmm. And that is because no one wants to commit to anything, as they're not confident about what the outcome is going to be. And because of that, they don't want to take accountability. Mm-hmm. So the fourth dysfunction is avoidance of accountability. They want to really avoid to take accountability of the outcome. And eventually, because there is no accountability, they are absolutely inattentive to the results. Mm-hmm. So they don't care what the results are. Or even if they know what the results are, it doesn't impact them or really affect them. So these are the five dysfunctions: absence of trust, leading to fear of conflict, leading to lack of commitment, leading to avoidance of accountability, and eventually inattention to inattention to results. So amazingly, I mean, it's a book worth while reading, and of course, implementing this in an organization and making the team aware about it really changes the dynamics of the whole team.
Fantastic. So Anish, now let's move on and talk a little bit about Forum. I know you are very passionate about Forum, a member of a Forum. I'm a member of a Forum. Yeah. But for the thousands of people who will be listening to us, what is a Forum?
So there are various definitions and various organizations who have adapted to this concept. But from my knowledge, I may be completely wrong, credit goes to IPO. Mm-hmm. As I believe IPO started the Forums, I think almost 57 years, 48 years ago, I believe. And when EO opted out of IPO, they carried the Forum concept with them. Mm-hmm. And these days, a lot of other organizations also, you know, they call it a cohort. TAI calls it the cohort. CII is Young Indians. They call it the inner circle. Mm-hmm. And of course, there are other names given to the same concept. It's basically a peer-to-peer support group. It's a group where everyone, through their experiences, empowers an individual or a forum member to take right decisions in their lives. Mm-hmm. I think that's a very simplistic definition of what a forum is. It's, of course, a non-judgmental space and a very confidential group as well, which helps people to open up and share what they're working on, learn from others' experiences, and then be empowered to take their own call.
So how do I form a forum? I mean, you know, you and I are talking.
Sure. So first of all, the forum can be formed group of friends. Mm-hmm. Like if they agree that let's take our friendship forward and become a forum, why not? Yeah. But then they have to go through the whole process into making sure that they follow the protocols. Mm-hmm. But to form a forum, in a structured manner, they need to be part of an organization which harbors the program called Forum, which YPO and EO definitely does, and so the other organizations as well. And I think the more diverse group is formed, the better the experiences members will get. And when I say diverse, it's age, male-female ratio, industry diversity, and that's just becomes an amazing, I would say, like a university. To learn from each other, and it's one of the best experiences they can get.
How can forum be used in the workplace? I mean, that's not a workplace, is not an organization of peers,
right? So at workplace, in fact, in my organization, I have adopted the forum concept. So whenever we do our weekly review, we begin with vulnerability. Mm-hmm. Right, we share what's working for us, our fears, our successes, individual, personal, and professional as well. And that's how we begin our reviews. And that just leads to a great connect between the leadership teams or marketing team or sales team, whatever group that you're talking about. And the whole concept of forum can be adapted, because one of the major elements that play a role in a successful forum is the mindset. Mm-hmm. You know, what mindset we have when we are with these peers. And the beginning of that is curiosity. Like, what am I learning today? Active listening, emotionally and mentally connecting to every individual in our group. Empathetic, you know, we have to be empathetic with each other, resonate with each other, reflect on our lives, and then share with each other. And while we do that, our whole intention is not about being smart or not about being superior. So we don't solve problems and we don't give advices. And the moment this is the whole concept is taken and put into the workplace, it really helps in making the team more cohesive, because one, they're more connected. One, it gives them an open space, a free space, a safe space to be vulnerable and talk what is stopping them from achieving the results. For example, if they're focused really on their results, and because everyone's empathetic and actively listening, they share from each other's experiences and help each other to learn and grow. So very much possible to bring the forum concept at workplace. In bits and pieces, I have, and I have got a lot of success in it.
Fantastic. One more question on forum before we move to the next segment.
Sure.
Can a forum be used in a family environment?
Absolutely. Absolutely used in a family environment. In fact, my elder daughter decided to go to a boarding school. And she was 15 and a half when she told me that. Very unlikely. Not expected that this would come to me. And, I sat with her and we had a very heart-to-heart conversation. And And I told her that I was the first, so her name is Asta. And I'm like, Asta, I was the first person in my family, in our family, in like all three generations to go out of the country at the age of 19 to study. This is what worked for me. This is what did not work for me. Mm-hmm. These are the things, these are the mistakes I made. And I still regret a few things. And I'm very happy and proud about a few things I did at the age of 19. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, she took a call and she decided that, Dad, I still want to go to a boarding school. And I think you understand my situation more than anyone else. You were the first. Now I am the first to go to a boarding school in the family. And it's a forum like conversation. So it's not, so it's, we don't really form a forum. We can in a family, but how can we implement forum concepts in the family is more important rather than doing a structured forum meeting in a forum. And it's very successful. It makes the family environment much healthier and more cohesive and more supportive rather than directive, you know, in terms of, you know, that this is what you need to do. It becomes more like a conversation, which really helps, gives everyone so much freedom to just share what they feel like without being judged. And
You know, Anish, what a fantastic answer. I mean, I've had a family forum with both my sons who live outside and left home 18 years ago.
Right.
But it's an absolutely incredible platform for communication for the family.
Absolutely.
Thank you. That's what a great answer this was. So, you know, moving on now, you also run a very, very successful gases business. My question to you is that, you know, a large business, which is probably a family business and what you're developing on your own, what would you say is your leadership style?
My leadership style is, first of all, I'm a very empathetic leader. Mm-hmm. And my general style is delegation. Mm-hmm. So I would, empathy is running parallel to whatever style I'm adopting. Mm-hmm. My imbibed style is delegation. I like to delegate and empower, and because I delegate and empower a lot, I always make sure I have right people on the right seats. Otherwise, my style won't work. But there are times when I have to be supportive. And there are times when I have to be directive. And there are times when I have to be a coach. So I work on all the leadership styles and I try to adapt whenever required. But my natural style is to delegate, but I'm also very empathetic. So every person in my organization is very much individually one-on-one connected to me. Even this last couple of months, they would just do me a video WhatsApp call while they're hospitalized due to COVID. And they would say, sir, I just want to talk to you. And I'm like, okay. So we have a conversation with them and just like some just normal conversations, not about work. And of course, they would bring about work because they're still coordinating things while they're hospitalized. Mm-hmm. But it would just become a natural flow of a conversation.
How amazing. Yeah. Fantastic. So now let me move to the last segment of our conversation, which are some questions for you personally.
Sure.
My first question to you, Anish, is that what would you say are three key milestones in your life or your career?
So the first milestone is when I went to US for my studies and I declared to my family that I would aspire to pay at least 2-quarter fees on my own. Mm-hmm. I began with an assistant to my professor. After 9 months on my I-20, I can get to work, and I did that. And I realized this is not enough for me to pay my quarter fees, which I was naive. I was very young, and I did not know. And then so I decided there's no other way out. So I started waiting tables at a fine dining Italian restaurant. And of course, I joined a sales company later on as well. After I finished my 1 year of my MBA, I joined a sales company, which was, of course, better. But initially, I started waiting tables. And And I realized, and that was my first realization, that what I'm good at, and I think that's a milestone, is I'm a vegetarian. I don't consume alcohol. And I was waiting tables at a fine dining Italian restaurant. Mm-hmm. I had to sell specials and I had to sell the best wines. Mm-hmm. Somehow I just was able to do so, which increased my ticket size for the table, the check size for the table. And that was 20, and generally 20% was I used to get as tips. Sure. And over the weekend, I used to make $500. And that was good in 1999, 2000, 2001, a good amount for the weekend, right? And that gave me a lot of confidence that if I have the knowledge and if I learn what is it all about, mm-hmm. I think I have the capacity to convince someone, and of course, genuinely, not to convince someone on something which is not true and right. Mm-hmm. That was my first milestone. The second important milestone was in 2016, when our families, we decided to amicably, very friendly, very nicely splitted. And I became an, so I demerged and I became an independent owner, mm-hmm. of a business. And all of a sudden, it was not just business development, which I was doing earlier, but overall operations, including finance, and everything just fell into my place, onto my lap, which was a milestone, which I realized that I think I need to relearn a lot of things. And of course, that was one milestone, which I think I crossed, and I have grown as a person, as a human. And the third one is when I began the Mind Maestro, when I realized that this is what I think is my passion. I love doing this, and why not impact as many individuals as I can through making them more and more self-aware.
Oh, wonderful. So my next question to you is that, you know, you've seen so much in life already and you're still very young. From where you stand today, Anish, what does success mean to you?
Most of the people see success as, you know, making an organization of a certain size, or, you know, ensuring that they have 5 vacation villas around the world. Because I'm also a follower of, so I love materialistic things. Okay, don't get me wrong. I love materialistic things, but because I'm a follower of BAPS Swaminarayan, there are certain things that have been imbibed into me since childhood, but I do love it, but I don't aspire much, you know, of those things. But I see success as, you know, if I walk into a room of 15, 20 people, mm-hmm. and at least 50% of the people come to me and we have a good chat and good greeting, and they like to talk to me because I have impacted their lives. That is what I see success as. Like, people come to you, talk to you, and want to keep relationships with you because you have influenced them in a positive way.
Okay. Terrific. So I've got time for 2 more questions for you. My next question is, who or what inspires you?
My guru. So my guru, Pramukh Swami Maharaj, who passed away in 2016, and my current guru, of BAPS Swaminarayan Sanstha, Mahan Swami Maharaj, they really inspire me. Not only because with absolutely, you know, servant leadership is what they have showcased, and they have grown the organization where they actually groom individuals and youth to become better humans. So they inspire me in every aspect.
Amazing. I'm a great follower of Babs as well.
Okay, nice. Yeah.
So my last question to you, and this is the question, Anish, on failure.
Okay.
You said people in India don't teach children it's okay to fail. We're always told, come first, go to the head of the line, etc., etc. Yet we fail, we make mistakes. So my question to you is, what have been some of your learnings from some of your...
So a very good question, Mr. Garg, actually. In fact, I was asked, I think just 3 days ago, that why do you love Purim so much? Mm-hmm. And I, my answer was that I love forums because it's one one place where I get permission to fail, and they won't judge me. Having said that, I have had my set of failures, and I've learned this through my EO journey, actually, that I started giving myself the permission to fail. And I have one of the, so we had a pipeline supply of industrial gases to the world's largest bulb manufacturing plant, which is Philips Electronics in Baroda. And we supplied cross-country pipeline, and it was constant oxygen, nitrogen being supplied to them. Through the relationship that we developed with them, we also, and of course, Crompton Greaves was nearby, so we were supplying to them also. And that led to, you know, of course, with, when you're like just in early 30s, you have a lot of adrenaline, you want to do new things. And I'm like, okay, let's build this relationship more. Let's begin assembling your, and LED was a new, what do you call, a wave in India. And even the government was promoting a lot of LED. And so I decided, okay, let's do job work. And let's begin an LED assembly, the PCB assembly division in our organization. And we began doing that. And for some reason we failed, and there are several reasons which are, but I think at the helm of the failure affairs of the division, it was me. One thing I realized that, yes, diversification is good, but I believe a lot of research needs to be done before I take the first step, which was my biggest mistake. Second was that it, from a process and a service-oriented business, which is oxygen and other industrial gases, this became more like a you know, like a step-by-step manufacturing chain or a line of business with 1,000 raw materials. I mean, the bomb was like a 1,000 things which we never, which I never have worked with. So I think lack of attention on those details was one of the reasons why that division wasn't successful. Henceforth, I have been very, very meticulous. Excel spreadsheets became the most important tool in my life after that.
Right.
Yeah.
Well said. Anish, thank you so much. It's been such a pleasure speaking to you. Thank you for what you're sharing, your amazing journey as an industrialist and as a forum guru. Thank you again and good luck.
Thank you very much, Mr. Garg. As I said, it was a pleasure having a conversation with you, and I hope to stay in touch with you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to The Brand Called You videocast and podcast. Platform that brings you knowledge, experience and wisdom of hundreds of successful individuals from around the world. Do visit our website www.tbcy.in to watch and listen to the stories of many more individuals. You can also follow us on YouTube, Facebook, Instagram and Twitter. Just search for The Brand Called You.